Podcast. So here we go. So welcome to another edition of the LBA Proyecto Podcast, the official podcast of the Latin Builders Association, and as I like to say, a companion to Proyecto Magazine. Today is a bit of a milestone for us. Again, I think we're doing something right, but today's a special day because with us today is a former president of the Latin Builders Association and the first former past president of the LBA to be part of the podcast. So this is going to get Bernie Navarro very upset. With us today is Gus Gil, who was president of the Latin Builders Association from 2005 to 2006. Welcome, Gus.
Thank you, Gus.
Where this is efficiency in name, but again, thank you. You run Gil Development, and Gil Development is a family company. I know it's been around for a long time. I think started by your dad and your mom. And it's always interesting. Your mom is the CFO. She runs the money, which is always very, very interesting and very traditional, right? Yeah. And you've taken on the role of president. And of course, Alex, your brother, is also involved, who's a longtime friend and a dear friend of mine for many years. So welcome. Gil Development is a builder of high-end homes. And you really kind of have a full take on all of South Florida because you've done stuff all over the
We've done a little bit of everything. We've been involved in every aspect of real estate in South Florida, you know, from mid-rise apartment units in the downtown area to warehouses out west and tract homes for many years. That was the bread and butter of our company for many years. And we've done office buildings, medical office buildings. Yeah. And, you know, so we've been at every aspect of the different products in the market. And now we're focusing more on high-end luxury home, residential luxury homes.
And I want to talk a little bit about that in a bit because I think that's interesting, right? There's a delineation in the South Florida real estate market between, you know, the affordable housing, workforce housing space and more towards the higher-end luxury home, both on the vertical and the single-family side. But before we get into that, I'm always curious, somebody like you that has such a legacy of service to the LBA and a long-standing relationship with the LBA, I'm always curious to see, how did you first get involved in the LBA? And as a follow-up, I want to talk a little bit about your years during presidency. I'm sure they were fun, so.
They were interesting, yes, very interesting. But so how I get involved is, so we had, you know, mutual friends that, you know, my dad had, and, you know, relationships like with the Adrian family and so on. And they were a big part of the Latin Builders. And slowly, you know, the LBA, as it started to grow and they had the foresight, you know, the early guys had the foresight on, you know, this being a generational association. And they created a group of individuals, young individuals, that it was called the trustees.
Okay.
So the trustees, I remember we always sat around the table with the old guard, right? And we had no vote. All we could do is listen.
Right.
And it kind of learned. So learn the steps that they took, the meetings, crazy, you know, when they had arguments, when they had this, when they supported a candidate, when they didn't. So it was very interesting because we got to learn the LBA from sitting in a room with these, you know, monsters, you know, that they were in the industry.
Right.
And that's how they created that group. And it was pretty much a lot of the sons of these individuals, you know, Peter Adrian, Albert Adrian, Charlie Martinez, and that group. And actually the only one that was not a trustee, it was a young guy, was Angel Medina, but because he was a banker at that time, and he actually had a vote, which we didn't. But we were, then they got us to participate and create the golf tournaments, the fishing tournaments. So we all participated in these things. And eventually, after I believe 2 years of, you know, us sitting on the sideline, they started incorporating us into the association.
That's a tremendous education because I think that's valuable. And by the way, I found a couple of old photos from your younger days. So we took some photos. Here's you with Charlie Martinez.
Hey, Charlie.
You guys were part of that group of leadership. And here's one with the late Lorenzo Luaces and alongside. And there's Angel Medina and Ovi Vento as well. Two dear friends. Yeah, and great guys. But what's interesting about that is that, you know, that legacy of service, and it was something that instilled early on for you. And you've always been very close to the association and very involved and with a watchful eye. And you've given me a lot of guidance. I'm always interested to know from folks like you, because I always I see the LBA as having had phases, right?
Yeah.
You were part of that phase that Charlie Martinez, Enio Medina, yourself, yep. Oivento, really a very healthy era of the LBA when there was a lot going on in South Florida. A lot of building was happening, a lot of construction.
I call it the second generation.
The second generation
of the LBA.
I think I'm part of the fourth generation.
I think you guys are the third or fourth.
Third or fourth generation. Maybe the bridge to the fourth generation.
I think so.
So, but it was interesting, but it's very interesting. And I'm curious to find out, give me your fondest memory of your time at the LBA during your presidency and maybe your biggest challenge as well.
So our biggest challenge, and it's interesting that you say the second generation, there were still, the office was still staffed mm-hmm. with the old guard.
Okay.
With the old people that were there.
Right.
Not in age, but
right.
in tender. And when we came in, we mm-hmm. started changing those things. And mm-hmm. I say when we, meaning Charlie Martinez first, Angel Medina second,
right.
me third, and then Obi following me. As presidents, those were eight years of presidency that really changed the whole structure yep. of the LBA, and it was, the challenge was, you know, how to deal with the old guard,
right?
Not the board members or directors, but with the staff, and we started making some changes, and obviously those changes,
yeah.
you know, have repercussions,
of course.
And they have, you know, you hurt some feelings and so on, but. You know, starting from Proyecto Magazine.
Right.
You know, Proyecto Magazine was one of the, you know, it is what it is today, mm-hmm. but that was a huge change. There was one person that was, you know, that wrote the magazine, edited, you know, sold the advertising
yeah.
and everything. It was a one-man show.
Right.
Written in Spanish, not even in
yeah.
English.
we still have some old copies yeah. here in the office. Right. Yeah. That's interesting.
That's yeah. interesting. So, so we took it, we grabbed that, and one of my tasks that Angel gave me as I was president-elect was, hey, we're gonna redo Proyecto. So, you know, I remember many, many nights going to the print shop, you know, yeah. because remember, we used to print this magazine every month.
Yeah. Man.
And it had to be done and printed by the lunch
wow.
of at the end of the month.
Yeah.
So, that means that Friday, 12 o'clock, that magazine had to be printed.
Had to be ready, yeah.
And that was, you know, usually the challenge. So I remember, you know, going to the print shop with Angel.
Right.
And you know, reviewing, you know, correcting if there's any changes, you know, kind of proofreading
right.
the magazine and making sure the ads were there and that it was done tastefully.
Yeah.
And then we, you know, obviously that also brought in different type of editing. You know, at right. one point I used to write, I had a page. And it was about all the industry stuff mm-hmm. and everything the LBA was doing. So that people started reading that because they wanted to know what changes were in the county, what was happening from a zoning, from codes and stuff like that. Because I would write every month an article on what happened, what transpired mm-hmm. Through that month
right.
in the county commission and in different municipalities. So, mm-hmm. so you know, it started educating people and it right. started going away from the, let's call it laboria,
right.
you know, type.
Right.
And it started getting more depth and more content to it. And you know, obviously with that, you know, sales changed
yeah.
and so on. And we also, through that era, we also did a huge change when it came to Southern Wine and Spirits.
Right, okay.
That was another big change.
Yeah, yeah.
And we looked at other, you know,
other
avenues
options,
yeah. and other options with different brands, and they came back to the table because of that pressure. Mm-hmm. They came to back to that. You know, originally we had a dinner, a gala, mm-hmm. and they put a bottle on the table, and
right.
that was their sponsorship, mm-hmm. which was great. You know, but you know, things change. People, not everybody drinks Black Label.
Got it.
You know, and especially you know the wives and stuff like that.
Right.
So we started going into the bars and opening bars and
right.
bringing different product, which was great because they got to advertise their different products.
Expose their different brands.
Yeah, absolutely, like from the vodkas to the rums to everything, you know. Yeah. So, actually, at first they were reluctant to, because everybody's reluctant to change,
Absolutely.
Because nobody likes change. So, but then when they saw it and they saw the possibility, and with that we added the back page. Mm-hmm. That's where the back page came, that they got one advertising every month on that thing. They spend more money with us, but we gave them also something back.
Of course.
And by doing, by changing Proyecto, we were able to change that whole.
So you ran it like a business, I think, to a certain extent. You applied your business acumen to the day-to-day of the LBA, which I think, in my opinion, is actually the right way of doing it. And by the way, you mentioned Proyecto. Our latest edition is out, Proyecto Magazine. This is featuring the financial mavericks of Metro Fund, Nelson Lopez, Orlando Diaz, and TJ Edwards of Walker Dunlop. So these magazines are available at all our events. And if you're interested in advertising, contact our office. Our next edition is coming up in the next few months. So it'd be great to get if you want to be on the magazine, it'd be great. So, but let me switch a little bit to the business side. By the way, you didn't give me your fondest memory.
Oh, my fondest memories.
Keep it clean, please. You know,
fondest memories. We had a lot of fun. We worked hard.
Yeah.
We applied a lot of time. You know, one of the things, the reason that I was able to apply the time is because the structure that our company had. Mm-hmm. And I always told you when we talked about your presidency, mm-hmm. There's a lot of time that you got to put into this.
Yeah.
And you have, by the way, I commend you for what you've done.
Thank
you've taken it to a different level. And I'm extremely happy that I continue to see how the LBA grows, because at the end of the day, it's our legacy,
absolutely,
right?
Which
is what I've always told you.
Yeah.
So, but with that said, going back, not to get away from your question, we made huge friendships. Our friendships are 30 years old, and it kind of all became, it was because the LBA, because that initial, trustee that I've mentioned to you earlier. So that's probably one of the best aspects I think that I can attribute to the LBA, is the friendships that we created, the bond that which we're still friends. And it was interesting because we're all competitors at one point.
That was interesting, right?
You're hanging out with the guys that it's trying to buy the same piece of property you're trying to buy, and develop the same type of product you're trying to buy, and you're going to market to try to sell that same product.
Right.
So it's interesting how we were all able to. So to me, that, and obviously the parties and and the fishing tournaments and all the memories, that we created, the Casa Campo trips that we would do. And then the whole family thing, right? So that whole connection. And still with the old guard still being involved, So, even though that we did all these changes at the LBA, we still kept that old guard involved, And I'll tell you, one of the presidents that's done it, I know you've been doing it, but also Bernie kind of did that. He tried to merge, because again, I think Bernie's presidency was that third generation.
That's right. That's right.
That's the third generation. That's what I would say. So you're the bridge to the fourth.
That's it. No, and I think it's important to bring that legacy with you. We've tried in each one of our Proyecto magazines to instill a. There's a section called LBA History.
I saw it.
This edition we're featuring
Johnny Beltran. I read the article.
One of the original, one of the original folks.
Actually, he was the founder. I don't know if you know that he's the one that did the paperwork to create the corporation, because he was probably the youngest one in that in that original group that probably spoke English English. So he was the one that incorporated Latin Builders Association.
And then that's why we have, we call him the voice of the old, even at his age now, and he's still doing great, but he's got that presence and that voice. There's only one Johnny Beltran. You mentioned a little bit on the business side. I kind of want to get into that, because I think you and I compare notes usually on municipal legislation and things of that nature. There's a lot happening now with the market and the monetary policy. As you mentioned, your focus on luxury homes, if you go on your website, some of the models and products that you've delivered are just really beautiful stuff in some of the higher end municipalities in town. I was curious to get your take on this, because CNBC reported in early March and highlighted Miami as one of the two markets that's being affected by this, that Luxury homes have dropped considerably, and the percentage was sizable, yet they kind of conditioned their statement by saying that there's still a tremendous amount of demand. So I wanted to kind of get your commentary on that, and then maybe we'll touch a little bit more on how you think the interest rates and inflation is affecting the market.
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's interesting that they focused on Miami, because usually when you get these articles or you get, it's nationwide, right? So, and we're totally different.
Right.
We're a different animal.
Yeah, I always say that Miami's insulated
completely
from the rest of the other country. The U.S., yeah.
Right. So, but since they did, you know, focus on Miami, I would tell you probably because they're just talking about luxury home.
Right.
But luxury home also is not just new construction, but old or used
homes,
right?
Right, exactly.
So what's happened, I think, it's that the people that were trying to second their sell their home and, you know, a secondary market, not new.
Right.
Those people were trying always to, you know, reach more. And obviously, they're going back, the interest rate has put a little bit of a small slowdown on all that. But with that said, what there is a huge demand for is new construction, especially from the folks that are coming from out of town, New York, Chicago, all those individuals are coming down, they're looking for new construction. They prefer, right? If they can't, obviously they'll go to...
And new construction more on the
single family side,
right?
No,
that's what I'm hearing as well.
Right. On the single family, but especially on the high end.
Right.
So
yeah.
we can't keep a house, you know, in the market for very long, new.
Right.
They get gobbled up right away. There's still that crazy demand for it, believe it or not.
Mm-hmm.
And for some of these folks that are coming from out of town, it does affect the local individual that's buying. The interest have affected the local individual. But the folks that are coming from out of town, first of all, they find our real estate to be, you know, relatively less expensive than where
they're coming from.
New York, wherever they're coming from. So they're thinking, wait, hold on, you know, this is cheap, you know, compared to where I'm coming from.
Right.
So those guys are coming a lot with a lot more equity. Mm-hmm. And more dollars. For example, right now we've sold a house in the Pines, you know, Ponce Davis area, which we're about to deliver, you know, to a gentleman that's in a fund in New York, and he's coming in and he's buying the house cash.
Wow.
He'll refinance and he'll get a line against that money and he'll play with that. But the deal is a cash deal,
right?
You know, so these people have those dollars and they'll leverage, you know, that with their bank, with their personal, you know, financials.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm trying to tell you is that those guys are still coming and paying top dollar. These houses are selling for over $1,000 a square foot.
That's amazing. No, and what's interesting, I had a conversation with the mayor of Miami on this issue because he's trying his level best to attract a lot of these new higher end businesses, right? The tech business, the financial fund, M&A companies, and the leaders of those companies, you know, may not necessarily want to live in a condo.
Right.
They're looking for a single family home and they want to live in something high end. So there's a little bit of, I wouldn't say frustration, but certainly a bit of a pull as to the ability to find, you know, good product. Coral Gables is a perfect example.
Right, perfect.
Coral Gables has a shortage of these higher end homes.
Absolutely.
There's some beautiful homes, you know, some older homes. But new product is difficult to find. So we're hearing that. So that's very much aligned.
Yeah. Remember, Gus, these people are coming, a lot of these people are young people.
Right.
Like these people are, the reason they're looking for single family homes and they don't want to be in a condo is because they might be living in New York in a condo.
Right.
They come to Miami.
Right.
They want to have a swimming pool.
Right.
In their backyard.
Of course.
Not on the rooftop.
Yeah.
Right. So because they want their kids to be able to have somewhere to throw a football.
Okay.
So that's the reason why these high-end homes are being gobbled up.
Right.
Because, you know, these clients that I just mentioned, they're probably in their 40s with two small children. So that's your market.
Yeah.
So those people want to have a backyard.
Yeah, they want to give them the Miami experience, the full Miami experience.
Correct.
So,
correct.
You know, particularly in some of the neighborhoods that you do a lot of work with higher-end municipalities, where you have the combination of good schools, you have a combination of great parks, really a full service community environment, and those folks, and I think that's the space. So I want to touch a little bit on monetary policy that we talked about a little earlier. Inflation was 8% a year ago. It's down to 6%. One can make the argument that some of the, policies that were put in place a while back are starting to work. As of March of this year, the Fed increased rates once again. And my concern is that that's going to have maybe too an aggressive move, and it's going to have an effect on the market, on maybe the not necessarily the luxury market, as you mentioned, where you have all cash deals, but just up to that.
Absolutely.
So I wonder if you could kind of put some light on that.
We've seen, I mean, we're not in that market right now, but I can tell you probably the big builders, you know, the D.R. Hortons and Lennars that sit on this board, you know, you could probably ask them, but I know that those markets are being a little bit more effective. I know that I can tell because, like, you know, on the manufacturers of roof trusses and stuff like that, I see that there's a little bit of a slowdown. And that means that the track home building has started to slow down a little bit. And I'm talking about areas out west and so on, where you have your, you know, your middle class, middle average person that has a job and so on. And, you know, the other, you know, the combination between high cost of construction, because
it has not adjusted downward at all.
100%. Yeah. So about this inflation down, you know, from 8 to 6, I haven't seen it.
You haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it
translate to the cost.
To the cost of construction. So therefore, these homes are still costing X, and then on top of that, you have these crazy insurance costs that is also now tag on a higher rate. You know, it's taking people out of the market.
Yeah.
So you're going to start seeing an effect. I mean, I don't know how long this is going to last. Mm-hmm. I hope that this inflation really works really quick, and maybe hopefully next year we start, you know, either kind of stabilizing and start dropping a little bit the rate, so that we can kind of pick up. But you know, the moves have been very aggressive, you know, and it's not government driven in the sense that it's just what happened with the market after the, you know, COVID and so on, that it just, you know, blew up for us, everything went up, and then now they've been trying to, you know, bring it down. But have you noticed there've been big swings, you know, it's a big swing up. Hopefully the swing comes, you know, kind of back down again and things kind of stabilize a little bit, you know. But it is definitely affecting.
I agree with you. I think I think it's something that we look at closely, and you and I have talked about it a bit. So why not kind of begin to wrap it up, you and I always talk politics and zoning and how local legislation and local politics tend to intersect. From a municipal level, even a county level, one of our advocacy positions has been the efficiency of permitting, the ability for builders such as you to be able to have a predictable path to a CO or even to just begin construction.
Right.
What are you seeing? I'm still not comfortable with the amount of time it takes once you purchase a piece of land to be able to put a shovel in the ground. How are you seeing the market or the process?
Yeah. So the process, obviously, is a different type of process when you're doing a high rise or you're doing, you know, tract development, or you're doing a single family. You know, in our specific case, you know, we've been doing homes in Pinecrest and in these areas, and especially even the Gables, there's a lot of areas that don't have sewer. Mm-hmm. So by not having sewer, you have to go through that HRS process for a septic tank system.
Yeah.
Now, January 1st, they changed the code on all of the systems. Yeah. Now it's an aerobic system, which has its pros and cons, you know, whatever, but it is what it is, and the idea is to be more environmental sensitive, you know, so we're okay with it. The process is the one that it's been a nightmare. So even though the county has done a great job, and we've been fighting for this for the last, you know, two decades, the county has a permitted system that has done very well. Everything is electronically done now, and a lot of municipalities are going in that route. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's a state mandate that by certain date, all these municipalities have to have electronic systems. Right. Coral Gables just recently went through it. You know, and obviously every time there's a new one, like it happened in the city of Miami, it becomes a little painful because of the learning curve, right?
Of course.
And even the people there.
Yeah, sometimes more of the people working inside.
Exactly. So, you know, so the Gables has been a little bit challenging but because of that. Hopefully in a year, you know, they get all the tweaks out of the thing and we can, you know, and all the kinks out and tweak it, and so that we can, you know, process like the county. But the issue with the county is that yes, they did this whole speed, and of, you know, getting your process done, your review gets done, but then HRS,
right,
which is a state, you know, what do you call
process,
it?
Process. Yeah, yeah.
You know, so they bog down the system.
Right, right.
So even though you can get all your plans approved, structural, this and that, but when you get to HRS, you can't get your permit. Yeah. And because you can't get that permit, it reflects on water and sewer not being able to get approved and so on. So therefore, we're back at the same thing. And by the way, that affects, you know, the municipality.
Mm-hmm.
It affects the county.
Of course.
Because it's throughout.
I'm encouraged by one thing, though. I did speak with a commissioner who's very much more in the forefront of that. And I think that permitting process that currently resides at DOH, at the Department of Health, at the state, they're going to take it into, because of the transition from sewer to from septic to sewer, they're going to take it back to the county. So we are hopefully, and we're going to work with the county to hopefully expedite that process once it lands in the county. We should see that before year end. So hopefully that'll be helpful.
You let me know if you need any help.
Yeah. Well, as always, I appreciate the conversation. You've been a mentor to me, and I very much respect what you've done for the LBA. And you know, this will hopefully be the first of many podcasts, and you get to be the first past LBA president to be in the podcast. So you know that I'll be getting a call from a few of them.
I might be envied.
Yeah. So thank you for coming on, Gus. It's great to have you. Thank you, guys. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you at the next edition.